Isekai. We all know it by now. Hell, one of your favorite anime is probably an isekai. The basis of isekai anime is actually pretty simple. Your favorite protagonist gets hit by Truck-kun and becomes overpowered in another world. But how exactly did the isekai genre start, and what made it so popular today? That's what we're gonna figure out today. So without any further ado, let's get started. The concept behind isekai has been around for a very long time, and it can be traced to ancient Japanese literature. One notable story, and possibly the earliest isekai work known today, is the story of Urashima Taro. The story tells of a fisherman who went by the name Urashima, and who saves a turtle's life from death. After saving this turtle, Taro is brought into an undersea world filled with lots of wondrous creatures. Taro spends what he believes to be about 4 or 5 days in this newly discovered undersea kingdom, but by the time he returns to his home village, he finds that it's now been some 300 odd years into the future. The story of Urashima Taro is one that modern-day isekai writers grew up listening to again and again. Stories like this have given birth to the isekai genre as we know it today. Interestingly, the foundational concept of isekai is not exactly unique to Japanese folklore. English literature like Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, The Wonderful Wizard of Oz, Peter Pan, and The Chronicles of Narnia are examples of other fantasy stories that involve entering a parallel fantasy world. Some of the earliest anime and manga titles that are considered an isekai today include the 1983 anime Aura Battle Dumbine, Mashinhira Wateru, NG Knight Ramune and 40, Fushigi Yugi, and El Hazard. In 2001, the anime Spirited Away became one of the most popular isekai films, even though at the time, it's not technically known as an isekai, because the term was not as common then. Till today, Spirited Away is still touted as one of the best isekai anime ever made, really. In 2002, Sword Art Online became one of the most popular isekai online novels, but it was the familiar Zero that truly made the isekai genre popular in the web novel and light novel genre. The familiar Zero is a story that I actually grew up watching, or an anime that I was watching. The anime tells the story of a male lead character, Saito, who is summoned to a fantasy world by the female lead character, Louise. In 2012, SAO was adapted into an anime, and this further popularized isekai in the anime genre, leading to the publication of more isekai web novels on the isekai website Shosetsuka Ninaro, known better as Naro for short. In 2012, the light novel Mushoku Tensei was launched in Naro, and for several years, it was the most popular novel on the site. It was one of the isekai novels that had their protagonists dying and being reincarnated into a different world, hence isekai. Following the success of Mushoku Tensei, the novel became a source of inspiration to many isekai writers afterwards. By 2016, the isekai genre had become so popular in Japan, as many writers hopped on the isekai bandwagon. It was so popular that in a Japanese short story contest, which was organized by Bugankō Free Market and Naro, the submission of isekai genres was banned. The organizers had probably seen enough of them and preferred to move creatively in a different direction. But what is it that makes isekai anime, manga, and novels so popular with fans? Well, the structure of the premise of isekai writings is simply too hard to resist. It appears that many audiences enjoy the thrill of exploding alternate fantasy worlds and rooting for their heroes in the process. I myself love isekai anime as a form of escapism, really. In order to escape the reality that we live in, sometimes you want to follow a character's arc in, you know, another world. Most isekai anime usually depict the protagonists having to learn about the fantasy worlds they find themselves in, and defeat some evil forces to either save the fantasy world or the real world they have left behind. The fact that both the protagonists and the audience are in the same boat as they learn to explore this new environment makes the adventures of isekai anime more immersive and relatable, except when they're extremely overpowered and they just do whatever they want. That's just a turn-your-brain-off anime, which we all love. In many ways, these protagonists are designed to feel like a stand-in for the audience. It's so easy to make the audience fall in line with the protagonists, as they can easily relate to the protagonist's struggles to understand their new world. In the earliest isekai animes, the protagonists were actually usually female characters. These include anime like Inuyasha, Fushigi Yugi, and Vision of Escaflowne, which I'm sure we've all heard of. The female leads in these anime had some psychic connection to some other place or another period in time. They also had some intuitive powers and special relationships that carved out their selection as the quote-unquote chosen ones. Usually, These female protagonists were paired up with male love interests who were often quote-unquote bad boys that tended to soften and become likable to the audiences. And the series progressed. The female leads were often engrossed in these romantic relationships as they also fought hard to defeat villains within their fantasy world, who usually had plans for the fantasy world, or even the real world. As time went on, we began to see fewer female protagonists in Isekai, and this was further amplified due to the enormous success of Sword Art Online. Isekai writers began to use the exploration of fantasy worlds as an avenue to have male leads fulfill their, harems in a new world with different cultural taboos. SAO was initially about a group of characters that were trapped in an online virtual reality game. But in addition to fighting the bad guys in the game and coming up with strategies to get through the game, the anime overlapped with the harem anime genre by introducing romantic elements into the series. It turned SAO into an anime favorite, believe it or not. Many isekai writers took notice of this and adopted Sword Art Online's approach while writing their own isekai pieces. Certainly, what contributed to the popularity of SAO was the increase of multiplayer online games. This was a period where gaming as we knew it was undergoing major changes, with the emphasis being on playing with a host of other online players in a VR world. Sword Art Online was a glimpse into the reality of what could happen if online gaming fans were literally consumed by the fantasy worlds they spent hours of their days wandering in. Speaking in broad terms, the isekai genre can be divided into two types. The first has to do with protagonists who transition into another world. This is called Isekai Tennai. The second involves protagonists who reincarnate into another world, and this is called Isekai Tensei. In earlier works, Isekai Tennai, where the protagonist transitioned into another world, was more common. Most times, this transition would happen by traveling into a new world or by being summoned into the other world. In later Isekai works, it became more common to see protagonists die in their original world, and then be reborn into another world. In some cases, the protagonist could swap places with the body of another person already existing in that world. Many writers employed plot devices such as, truck-kun, to create this swap that involved the death of the protagonist. In either type of transportation into a virtual world, the new world where the protagonist finds himself could be a literal new world like an alternate planet, or it could be mere fantasy. In some cases, the protagonist could be transported into a historical, real-world setting that would be completely new to them. And in cases where the new world is pure fantasy, the protagonist could wake up in a book, a film, or a video game. Some isekai works depict protagonists who are pretty much ordinary people in their real worlds, but find themselves in a fantasy world where they're able to succeed thanks to some real-world skills or knowledge that were unimportant in the real world, but give them an edge in the fantasy world. These skills could be as simple as cooking meals or as technical as engineering skills. While these might be normal skills in the real world of the protagonist, they could be pretty vital skills for them if they are transported to another world that's not as advanced as modern Japan. The protagonist could also possess some special skills or equipment in the fantasy world that only they have access to. Also, the protagonist could be blessed with incredible amounts of power and magical abilities in their fantasy worlds that make them extremely overpowered and for a lame story, but could be relatively weak with no special powers gained upon their entry into the new world. This was the case in ReZero, one of my favorite isekais, where the protagonist did not possess any special powers after entering the alternate world, apart from the ability to survive death and what looked like a type of temporal loop. In this isekai work, My Next Life as a Villainess, All Routes Lead to Doom, the protagonist is transported into the body of an unimportant villain in the other world. This take veers away from the traditional chosen hero role that most protagonists in early isekai works played, and there have been many works that have also towed this path. In Drifters, the people who enter the fantasy world are historical generals and warriors in the real world, who are more ferocious and more brutal than the individuals they inhabit in the alternate world. Some isekai even involve protagonists being reincarnated as unusual inanimate objects. Another interesting offshoot of the isekai genre is called the second chance, or reincarnation genre. In this type of work, the protagonists, after dying, find themselves in the body of their younger selves. This approach to isekai is a product of a fantasy that almost all of us have thought about at some point in our lives. The protagonists are allowed to relive their lives from a younger age with the experience and knowledge gained from their older selves. All these attributes of isekai are what make the genre so popular. The fantasy, the immersion, and the relatability of the stories in this genre have lured millions of anime fans. And although there are a lot of trashy, harem-based OP character having, you know, rom-com type of isekais that we know are trash. Everybody knows they're trash. Come on, they're garbage. But we love garbage here. And we love those trashy rom-com harem-based OP character having stories sometimes. That said, not many people are fans of isekai. It took me a while to warm up to it too. For one, the overuse of the concept has gotten many anime fans bored. It's a structure they have seen repeatedly in various manga and anime, and this is not even exclusive to anime as the idea is also prevalent in Western entertainment. Harry Potter, for instance, has all the features of an isekai work. The idea of finding yourself in some new unknown world is not new, and for some, it's time to put the fad to bed and move on to more other exciting plots. But perhaps the reason for this perception amongst many anime fans, including myself sometimes, is not the concept of isekai has been overused, but rather that in many cases it's poorly adapted. One could argue that many isekai writers have taken advantage of the effect that isekai has been winning the audience over to the side of the protagonist pretty easily. Many writers have nothing more exciting to offer beyond the premise of their stories, and when you come across lots of isekai works that are desperately lacking in quality, it becomes easy to write off the genre as a whole. I mean, come on. Whereas isekai anime series like Spirited Away, Poppin' Q, SAO, ReZero, and Konosuba are excellent animes in their own rights. Another common critic of isekai is its growing overlap with harem anime, which I personally love, don't judge me, where writers substitute quality writing for cheap sexual fantasies just to lure in more followers, including myself, because I'm trashy like that. Yes, the ploy is tiring to see, and it's sadder that we're seeing more isekai anime following this trend. Sometimes I still enjoy it though. But for all the downsides one can spot with this genre, it's undoubtedly growing in popularity, and is likely to be around for quite a long time. We can only hope to get more memorable, expertly crafted anime in this genre that will explore the strength of isekai to its max, and deliver more iconic characters that we could all enjoy watching. With that being said, if you guys could drop a like and share this video around for many people that don't know what isekai anime is, that would be greatly appreciated. I've been Broken Obsessed in my otaku ways, and I will see all of you lovely people next time.